Hey everyone, I'm Max Margenot, and I'm here to talk about tradable universes. Whenever you take up a position in the financial market, you are expressing some view that you have on that market. By buying a stock, you are implicitly saying that you expect the value of that stock to go up. Similarly, by going short on a stock, you are implicitly saying that you expect the value of that stock to go down. The whole point of taking up these different positions is to express a view, and ideally increase the value of your holdings. When you enter into a trading algorithm, you are just expressing a more complex view of how you expect the market to behave. You're going to have an intricate set of various different positions, long and short, that will express what you think is going to happen, what your model thinks is going to happen going forward. So it's critical to make sure that your algorithm can actually trade what it wants to trade. And this is the point of having a tradable universe in the first place. When you have an algorithm and you set it off into the market, and you don't specify what you want it to trade, it's going to try to trade everything, right? This is kind of the key advantage of having a trading algorithm in the first place, that we can quickly analyze many different individual securities and come to conclusions about whether we want to go long or short on any of them individually or collectively, and how long or short we want to be on those securities. Now, what's key here is that in order to actually express the view that the algorithm wants, it needs to be able to make those trades. It needs to have some whitelist of all securities in the market that it can actually enter into and just look at in the first place in order to take out positions. Sometimes you just can't make a trade even though you want it. This is a structural issue that happens a lot with penny stocks and stocks like them. Penny stocks are stocks that are very lowly valued, and sometimes there just isn't enough volume for you to actually execute a trade. Sometimes you are a large proportion of the total volume for that stock, in which case the market starts to move against you. But in many cases, you just can't make it. And if your trading algorithm is trying to access a lot of these penny stocks or similar securities, it's going to fail on a lot of individual trades. So we want to make sure that we're excluding this sort of stuff. Another reason why we might want to restrict the number of securities and the particular securities that our algorithm looks at is because all good trading algorithms are based on some economic hypothesis. And an economic hypothesis often comes with some set of assumptions on the trading universe that you're trading within, right? If you have a hypothesis that is based only on technology stocks, then it makes no sense to trade it on other sectors. You want to trade it just within technology. So taking together these structural issues where you just might not be able to execute a trade and characteristics of the particular hypothesis that you're trying to express, it makes a lot of sense just to implement some whitelist so that you're only trading stocks that you can actually trade, stocks that are sufficiently liquid, and so that you're only trading stocks that are in tune with your hypothesis. And this is how you make sure that you have a good trading algorithm in the first place.